The number of confirmed coronavirus cases across the world is now more than 40 million. And once again, experts are warning that the actual tally is likely to be much higher. The U.S., India, and Brazil are reporting the highest number of cases, but the current surge is being driven by Europe, which has seen over 240,000 confirmed deaths from the virus so far. This comes as former FDA Commissioner Dr. Scott Gottlieb warned the current wave of new coronavirus infections is likely to be the, quote, biggest wave the U.S. experiences before a vaccine is readily available.
We have two or three very hard months ahead of us. I think this is probably going to be the hardest phase of this pandemic. The good news is that we have a lot of medical treatments and better medical care, so we're going to do a better job of preserving life. The bad news is I think we're going to end up infecting a lot more people.
For more on this, let's bring in Dr. Ron Elfenbein. He's an emergency care physician and author of Surviving Coronavirus, an ER Doc's Perspective. Doctor, really, really stark warning there from Dr. Gottlieb. Talk to us about this, what he calls biggest wave, and what can be done at this point to mitigate that.
Well, good morning, Vlad and Emery, and all your viewers. I think that was a very scary and a little bit prescient sort of prediction by Dr. Gottlieb. If you look at the history of pandemics, there's always sort of a first initial wave, and then things kind of go down a little bit, and then there's always a second wave. And historically speaking, the second wave is usually worse than the first wave. So I think part of what he's speaking about is historical norms. But second of all, we do know that coronaviruses tend to be more active, if you will, in the wintertime, in the cold weather. So we're going into the cold weather. We're going into cold and flu season. Kids are going back to school. People are sort of tired of being locked down. We're relaxing our standards. We're relaxing our policies about interacting with other people. And that would naturally lead to more infections. But I think the most important take-home point that he said, in my opinion, is that the fatality rate will be going down. And I think that everybody agrees with that. If you were going to catch coronavirus, the best time to catch it would be now or in the future, not in the past, because we have much better treatments. We have much better protocols. We have much better options now to keep people alive. So the good news, the silver lining, if you will, is that we have a much better medical care available to people. But I think he's right. I think the numbers were going to continue to go up. I'm not a doomsayer. I'm not a gloom and doom kind of person. But I think that he's absolutely right that this wave will be worse than the original.
So, Doctor, according to the Associated Press, vaccine shortages could mean billions of people will be left without access to immunization. And apparently nearly 3 billion people, 3 billion of the world's population, live where temperature-controlled storage is insufficient, because we're talking about vaccines that need to remain cool. So, you know, we've been hearing over and over again that, you know, the vaccine is what we need. It's going to be a game changer. But can you kind of just go through some of the factors, some of the questions that will have to be considered when we're talking about widespread distribution of a vaccine, and just how long that would take?
Yeah, it's a really good question. So you're talking about two different things, I think. One would be inside the United States, and then one would be the rest of the world. And I don't want to I don't mean to sound callous by lumping everybody together at the rest of the world, but, you know, the rest of the world encompasses a large number of third world countries, as you pointed out, the vast majority of which do not have access, readily available access to refrigeration that in general is required to keep these vaccines working, so to speak. So, you know, within the United States, we have a problem in that, despite the fact that we have all these vaccine doses being made, who's going to get them first? And how do you sort of get them out there? So, you know, we've talked in the past about glass vial shortages. Well, the vaccine has to be stored in glass vials. There was a shortage of glass vials. The federal government spent a lot of money under Operation Warp Speed to get companies to manufacture millions and millions and millions of these little tiny glass vials that can keep the vaccine stored safely and sterilely. You know, these supply chain problems are logistic problems are really the big ones. And you don't think about it, but even like getting enough needles, getting enough syringes, all these things become huge problems when you have to talk. You're talking about billions of doses. And then, of course, getting them to sub-Saharan Africa, where, again, there's not a lot of readily available refrigeration in these small villages. Even in the United States, even in some rural villages in Alaska or on Native American reservations, they don't have access to good and reliable electricity to provide for reliable refrigeration. which then becomes a problem because you can't store these vaccines. So then they have to be brought inside of coolers that are kept temperature controlled, and you're very limited in how many of these you can carry, obviously. So getting the vaccine out to people is going to be a huge problem, specifically in the rest of the world. The United States to some extent, but the vast majority of it's going to be the rest of the world.
Pfizer is now the front runner in the race to deliver a coronavirus vaccine. In an open letter, the company says it will seek emergency use authorization, but the earliest doctor that it could apply is the third week of November. So with that kind of a timeline, how soon could the vaccine become available for wide distribution in the U.S.?
Well, the good news about that is that they're ramping up production of it under the assumption that they're going to get the emergency use authorization. So I want your viewers to remember that everything that's coronavirus related does not get FDA approved. It gets what's called an emergency use authorization. That means that the data is limited, but the FDA is making its best judgment to say, yes, this is good for coronavirus, or no, it's not good for coronavirus. Normally, it takes years to get FDA approval, but nothing for coronavirus has been approved. It's all been authorized. So in this case, the FDA requires 2 months of safety data after the last vaccine dose has been administered. The Pfizer dose requires two doses of the Pfizer vaccine requires two doses of vaccine. And they said that the last doses were administered towards the end of October, which would put it, as you said, Vlad, in the third week of November when they can first apply for the EUA. So Pfizer is ramping up production and the assumption that they're going to get the EUA. So once that EUA is hopefully given, that there'll be enough vaccine to then start distributing, as opposed to waiting for the EUA and then ramping up production. So I think they're doing it the right way. My hope, and obviously everybody's hope, is that this vaccine is efficacious and safe.
So there's a recent study by the Department of Defense that suggests that the risk of contracting an airborne virus, such as the coronavirus, is very low when traveling on a commercial aircraft if passengers wear surgical masks continuously. Can we talk a little bit about the study? What does that mean? Surgical masks, is that different than kind of the white and blue mask that most people wear? Are we talking about the N95 masks, or what do you know so far about this research?
So the study was actually very interesting and quite elegantly done, but there are some limitations with it that I want people to understand. So the essentially what they did was they used a faux plane, so they packed the plane, but they packed it with mannequins. And some of the mannequins were wearing masks, some of them weren't. At times they took the masks off, and they had what's called an aerosol generator, which is a little machine that simulated breathing and coughing inside the mannequins. The problem with the study is that the mannequins sat still. Obviously, they turned their heads, they didn't move, they didn't go to the bathroom, they didn't open up bags, they didn't move, you know, they weren't getting books, they weren't reading, they weren't doing things that humans would normally do on an airplane. So the study was very, very interesting, but was limited because it was just a mannequin that didn't move and didn't turn. That being said, it did show that 99.9% of aerosolized particles are removed by the HEPA filters, and the fact that airplanes in particular have amazingly good and efficient airflow, that something like every 5 or 6 minutes, the air in the cabin is completely turned over. So I would say, from my personal experience and my understanding, that yes, airline travel is relatively safe. But this study is limited in the fact that it was mannequins, not human beings, and that they were not moving. They were just staring straight ahead. But yes, the masks that they were using were surgical masks that most people have, just the little cotton masks that fit over your face, polypropylene masks, not the cotton ones that people buy, and not the sort of socks that some people wear, that like bandanas. They were actually surgical masks that we would use in the operating room that are made of polypropylene. But they're readily available. People can buy them at Walmart. You can buy them at Costco. You buy them at Sam's Club. You know, they're cheap. They're easy to get. But yes. So I think people shouldn't be necessarily afraid of flying, but you should wear a mask. You should limit what you touch. The same things we keep talking about. Wash your hands. Limit interactions with other people. And the other thing is that this study did not look at people interacting in the airport, people looking on the jetway, waiting to get on the plane, all those other things that go along with airline travel.
Yeah, I mean, one of the first things that happens, you know, sort of as soon as the plane is reached altitude, is they ask if you want a drink and something to eat. And yeah. If you've ever had to wear, you know, some of these masks for a long period of time, you know, you move your head, maybe you move down, you go back up, it shifts a little, you forget that it dropped under your nose, you pull it back up. So it's really good to sort of give us all the factors to consider, because it's like every day there's a new study that comes out. And so hearing all the factors to consider helps us interpret the information that we're getting on a regular basis. Dr. Ron Elfenbein, thank you so much.
Thank you, guys. Stay safe.